Hello, hello. Good morning, good morning. It's good to be with you this morning. We have some really good worship planned. Tender time of writing prayers with the children and thinking through who goes where when. We're excited to be leading worship with you this morning. We have a couple of important announcements we want to share right now. But next week, we have the annual program meeting. It's our chance to celebrate the ministries over this past year, but really over the past 23 years. This is one of our retirement celebrations. So it's a meeting, but really it's a party. Go for it. Blow. Blow hard. Yes, good. Well, oh, it's going to be a party. Good. So annual meeting next Sunday after church. You will help it be a party by bringing some delicious food to pass. You can see the notes about that in the bulletin. The party continues next Sunday because in the evening, we're going to have a church family bowling outing. So let's see who's going to show us. Ruby, go for it. Show us what's going to happen next Sunday between 5 and 7. Oh, yes. Roll that. Uh-huh. Knock them over. We're going to go bowling together. Yes, good. And we all, yes, Ruby, good. So we hope next Sunday that you join us for bowling. That's from 5 to 7. It'll be a chance to kick back, relax, and have some fun together. There's a sign up out in the hallway. You can sign up online to all kinds of places. We hope that you can come. All right. And then we want to make sure that you saw this week the invitation to the big retirement party, which is in May. If you didn't get an email about that, would you let us know? Because then we want to make sure you get on the email list. It was in the newsletter, but also came out as an email. So we are going to have a special party to celebrate Paul. So let's make our party sound again. Can you guys do our party sound again? Go for it. Party sound. Yes, good, good, good. Ooh, takes a lot of air to make those work. Good, thank you. All right, so lots of things. Is this me, Clay? That sound? I don't know. Paul, is your mic on? I wonder what's going on with that sound.
We'll figure it out.
Okay, so we're going to have a party. It'll be a blast. We hope that you come May 18, 4 to 6 p.m. You can RSVP, let us know, because we are having a catered meal, so we need to have a head count. So please let us know as you are able. All right, we are ready to start with our call to worship.
With eyes to see.
Your turn. And ears to hear.
With lips to sing.
And hands to help. Let us worship God with our
things, be still and know. If you're in godly play, come on, Simeon. Come on, Ivy. Amelia, come on up. And so we're going to sing with you the song we sing to get our minds and our hearts and our bodies ready. Okay, are you ready to sing together? Be still and
the Good Shepherd. The Good Shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand who is not the shepherd does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. The wolf snatches and the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the Good Shepherd. I know my own, and my own knows me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold, so I must bring them also. And they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down in life order and to take up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down. I have power to take it up again. I receive this command from my Father.
The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This song really quick. So if you know these kids, you know they like to move around a lot. So I wanted to write a little song where they could tell me what movements they want to do when they think about God. So I asked them last week to supply the words, and we're going to sing it and do those movements for you.
Thank you. from First John. We know not by this that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another. How does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother, sister, sibling in need and yet refuses to help?
Little children, let us love, not in word or speech, but in truth and action. And by this we will know that we are from the truth and will reassure our hearts before God whenever our hearts condemn us. For God is greater than our hearts, and God knows everything. Beloved, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have boldness before God and we receive from God whatever we ask, because we obey God's commandments and do what pleases God.
And this is God's commandment, that we should believe in the name of God's Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as God has commanded us. And all who obey God's commandments abide in God, and God abides in them. And by this we know that God abides in us by the Spirit that God has given us.
The word of the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
you for leading us in worship today. Thank you for playing the piano and the recorder. Thank you for writing prayers. Thank you for leading us in the readings. Thank you for singing and dancing, all the things. We have a gift the church wants to give you, and we have a gift for each of you as a house. So if you have a sibling, would you sit by your sibling? Can you find a spot next to a sibling if you have a sibling up here? And then I'm going to give you a gift from us. Some of you saw this book yesterday. This book is called, Eleanor, I'm going to put that right in the middle of your group. Emma, here's one for your house. Here's one. Lucas, would you come over here by Emma? Thank you. And I would like you to start looking in this book. We've been talking about all different names of Jesus and of God, our names. We learned the names of the campus, the students, the college students last week. Would you look and see if you can find the page that has the hen? See if you can find the hen page. One for the Sewell family and for the mass. Can you share that? Good. Do you want to share with Penny Simeon? See if you can find the page with the hen. Good, Emma found it. Find the page with the hen. It's kind of in the middle. And this is a book that describes how God is like a mother. And there's this page about the hen. Oh, let's see, good, keep looking. You're gonna get there. It says, God is like a mother hen who gathers chicks under her wings. Well, our friends Benji and Ollie, Pastor Paul's grandkids, they have chickens at their house. They brought their chickens here not too long ago. And the chickens have wings, and they taught me about how the baby chicks do go right underneath the wing of the mama, of the hen. So this is, God is a mother hen who gathers chicks under her wings. I wonder what it feels like to be there. I wonder what that helps us know about who God is. I want to share a big word with you. It's not a long word, but it's a word we use mostly at church. Can you say the word abide? Abide. And I think we can think about those little chicks inside the mother hen's wing, that the chicks are abiding with the mama, and the mama is abiding with them. They are connected. And we hear today, in the readings that we heard, that Teresa and Lucas read, that we abide with God when we love God, and when we love one another, then it's like being up inside the chicken's wing, the hen's wing, when we love God and love one another. So, the invitation today for us and for everybody gathered and for those who are worshiping at home is to abide with God, because that's where love is. So take a minute. Imagine yourself as a baby chick. Can you do it? Maybe close your eyes. Close your eyes. Take a big deep breath in through your nose. And out through your mouth. And now imagine that you're a baby chick. And now imagine that you're tucked in underneath the mama hen's wing. That seems like a good place to be. And from there and in there, you get to be love. Love for God and love for one another. Ooh, let's abide in that spot, because God abides with us. Emma, what are you thinking about? Oh, Simeon, did you hear what Emma was saying? She was telling a story about when she was imagining what it was like being tucked in the mama's wing. She thought maybe people could see her at first, but then she was so tucked in that maybe nobody could see her in that space. You were using your imagination. Good. Let's pray together. Can you do something weird? Can you pretend to be a wing? Make a wing with your arm. And then pretend your hand's a little chicken. Oh, a little chick. And then tuck it in there. We're gonna pray like that. Okay, first make your chicken wing, your mama hen wing, and then put your baby chicken there. Someday we'll teach you how to make noise like that, but not today. Okay, hey God, we are thankful that you love us and that we love you. Help us abide tucked in underneath your mother hen wing. Help us love you and love one another. In your son's name we pray. Thank you.
I bring sad news today for some of you in particular. We've received word this very morning before worship that former pastor of this church, Bob Wallace, has passed away this week. We remember Peggy and his many loved ones in our prayers today. Let us pray. Holy God, in this ongoing season of Easter, grant us courage to keep seeking and claiming resurrection. Where we may have fallen into deathliness, help us to rise and choose life. Where life has drained from our relationships, awaken us to our part to give new life a chance. Where our world seems too far gone, let us not give up on what you mean for this world to be. Let us not give up on this beautiful earth. Let us not give up on seeking righteousness, justice, kindness. May we get up from our indifference and rededicate ourselves to reclaiming what is right and lovely and true. May we live like children of the resurrection. We pray today for those who are suffering close by us and those who are suffering far away. For those who suffer war or hunger or fear. Fear for their lives and for the lives of their loved ones. For those who suffer despair or addiction or depression, we lift them into the light of your loving kindness. May we never be people who withhold ourselves from the fellowship of the suffering. For you are there and will meet us there. Once more today, we pray for the people of Gaza. And we pray for the people of Ukraine. We pray for Peggy Wallace and for all the loved ones of Bob Wallace. We pray also for Jill Damon, Mervyn Newcarts, David Gregg, Joyce Robbins, Esther Floyd, Marlene Francis, Eva Kelly, Betty Gerstler, Marilyn Marsh, Catherine Cartier, Keith Maurer, the McLeod family, Mike Kelly, Beth Granberry, Grange Burnside, the Sanford family, Simona Butler, John Rowe, and Faye Key. And now in these moments of silence, each of us offers the prayer of our God, into your hands, we place all our thanks and all our needs and all of the needs of your beautiful, aching world. All in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Imagine that you are given this assignment this week. As often as you can, say love, but not with words. For as many people as you can, or as many groups as you can, say love. Unmistakably say love, wordless. But why keep it to a week? Let's just do it for a whole year. How would you do it? Lots of hugs? The way you look into people's eyes? By helping, hosting, sharing, giving something? And how much would change for you, do you suppose? Would anything feel different to you as you walk down a street? Or go to work? Or come to church? Or in how you think of your home, your time, your possessions? Won't you be glad when that year is over? Or maybe you won't be glad. And we'll decide to keep it going. Now with the added benefit that you're free to use the words. And when you do take up using the word, do you suppose that love, the word love, might have more resonance in it for them? And for you, because you have done so much just showing it. Either way, our imagined assignment comes straight from a letter we call 1 John in the Bible. Little children, let us love not in word or speech, but in truth and action. To tell you the truth, I wish he'd said that a little bit differently. Instead of beginning, let us love not in speech, I think it might have been at least a little better to say, let us love not only in speech, because who really could live a life expressing love without letting it flow into our words as well? It is, you know, a false distinction to think of words as entirely separate from deeds. Because words are deeds. They are deeds of the lips. And to speak the right word, in the right tone, in the right moment, may have magnificent power to transform. It's a wondrous thing to say or to hear, I love you. So when John says, let us love not with words, I'm sure he means something different. He means, let's stop talking about love apart from expressing it also in definite action. Love not lived isn't love at all. Wendell Berry said, love in the abstract is a contradiction in terms. We delude ourselves when we speak of love or have sweet feelings about love and somehow think we've done the thing. This is one of the great seductions of worship. We say all the right words. We love the singing that we do here. We love how it feels. It feels so right. And sometimes I can almost hear a sigh of satisfaction. Didn't we get it right? Isn't this who we are? When, of course, it's not who we are unless and until we do it. Sometimes when worship thrills us, it may also fool us. We said it right, got it right, sang it right. That's what we needed when, in fact, what somebody needed most was a meal, was our time, was tangible help, was advocacy, was housing, a just wage, full and outreaching welcome into friendship. If good feelings and good words don't take form in such action, they are not real enough. And through the gap of that disconnect, a dry wind may come howling, blowing against the words we spoke, turning them to dust, making them a lie. By the way, when I came up with that last sentence, I kind of liked it. Until I realized I'd done it again. More words. Words about love. Abstract. But our text today comes down from abstraction to single out a specific. And the specific situation is what we do with our money, our resources, when we've got them, and we know the needs of others around us. John says, how does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees brother, sister, sibling in need and refuses to help? You say you know God's love and you have resources, and then you see concrete needs around you and you don't help? You don't know love at all. So John says, let us love not in word but in action. So in the word action, he is pointing specifically to our bank account, to our economics, to the sharing of actual resources. But there is a surprise here. We might assume that the issue here is helping people with their problems. But the text is pointing to the fact that we are the ones with the problems. We are the ones in need of help. In particular, that we have that we live with and struggle beneath. Uncertainties, self-doubt, uneasiness in our skin, and weakness of faith. And it may be largely due, in fact, to our failures to act in love. Listen to what he says. When we express love in our failures, I'm sorry, when we fail to express love in our failures, our hearts accuse us. And he adds, by this we will know that we are from the truth and will reassure our hearts when our hearts condemn us. And if our hearts now do not condemn us, we have boldness before God. That's quite a claim. When our hearts accuse us, then giving genuine, active expression of love for others may very well reassure our hearts. And the self-accusing may be calmed, at least for a while, and we are made bold. Does anybody here maybe know just a little bit about trying to live with an accusing heart? Anybody here haunted by an inner prosecutor? It whispers to you or screams at you that you're no good, you're a fraud. You're a failure, your unforgiven sins remain unforgiven. You don't have what it takes and you will never change and you are clearly not a real child of God. Our text today knows about this, as most of us do, as I do. We may have done all kinds of the right things, and people around us may shower us with affection and even praise, but still our hearts accuse us. And if we confess our sins and experience grace and know we are held entirely in perfect love, that grace will help us do better. Yet still our hearts accuse us. Not all of us, but most, I think. Where does that stuff come from? Who put that prosecutor in place? Maybe something in how we were raised? Something culturally imposed? Religiously imposed? A shame addiction? The devil? Whatever the source, our hearts do accuse us. And the accusing quite often is false. We can take it to therapy. We can take it to church. We can take it to honest conversations with friends. We can take it to our prayers. But John says, consider also this. Give active, authentic, concrete expression of love for others, and your accusing heart will find some reassurance. Why? Because considering how to love others and acting in love toward them can turn us from being so curved into ourselves. Love's concerns can gently, steadily through time, crowd out tyrannical self-concern. But more than this, the way of actively expressing love brings us into union with God. For as John also says, God is love, and if we love, God abides in us and we abide in God. So the inner prosecutor is told to give us a break. And our hearts are reassured, and we are made more bold. God is love. And consider this. The universe was born 13.7 billion years ago, give or take half a billion. And before this event, God was. And God was love. If this is so, how can we see the birth of the universe as anything but divine love's beautiful, powerful, explosive expression of itself into action? Every far-flung atom of it, divine love's expression of itself. And here in this little planet we call home, everything here is the fruit of this love's expression in truth and action. The mountains and oceans, the animals and the air we breathe, the new greening of the trees, and we ourselves. We all together inhabit this love-made world. And when we live our lives giving expression, flowing with expression to that love, we are uniting ourselves to all nature. And we are becoming united together in Christ, the Word made flesh, and we are living at last in league with God. If you want to think of the word of love sometimes as a grim and heavy obligation, go ahead. As that sometimes just how love in action will feel. But here is the truth. To love in truth and action is not only necessary and crucial and urgent and sometimes difficult. It is most of all wondrous. It is to find our home in the cosmos. It is to abide in God and find God abiding in us. Dorothy Sayers, the great mystery writer and lay theologian, said, "If they ever ask me to preach, I know what I'll say. I'll get up and say, 'You know what to do. Do it.' And then I sit down." So do it. Friends, let us love not only in words and speech, but in truth and action. Amen.
Friends, before we share the benediction with you, I just wanted to say thank you. Hello. We wanted to say thank you to our choir director, Coley, who has been leading the children, along with Heather, who has been volunteering every Sunday for weeks on end. So we wanted to give thanks for you guys today. Thank you for your ministry with the kids. We're grateful. Yes, we can clap for them. Heather, we receive your gift of time and love as a gift of love, so thank you. These flowers are for you, so make sure you each take flowers home. All right, now will you receive the benediction?